So if you're like me, your social media has been recently filled with test results that look like this. This test result is based on the idea that people can have one half of their brain dominant over the other half, and that fact can predict other things about people's personality and thinking. Supposedly, if your left hemisphere is dominant, you're more analytic and rational, whereas if your right hemisphere is dominant, you're more of an imaginative artist. And also, if you're like me, you're disappointed that this myth about brain function has survived for as long as it has. Now, this idea didn't come out of nowhere, unlike that tired, you only use 10% of your brain trope. But the actual experiments that people claim are the basis for these surveys and test results don't actually resemble the myth that it has become. So what's the evidence, and what's the myth it grew into? It all started in the 1960s when Michael Gazzaniga and Roger Sperry had the opportunity to work with some patients who had brain surgery to treat severe epilepsy. The surgery cut through the tracts of nerve fibers that connect the two halves of the brain, called the corpus callosum. For lots of patients, the surgery successfully reduced the frequency of seizures. These researchers took advantage of the fact that each half of the brain receives input from one half of the body, the opposite half. However, there's an exception to this organization: your eyes. Nerves from your eyes are organized such that light coming in from your left hits the right side of both eyes, and then is carried through your retina and optic nerve to the right side of your brain. So in this way, the right side of your brain doesn't just handle input from your left eye, it handles visual input from, well, whatever's to the left of you. So these two researchers wanted to see if input was handled any differently by the brain if it was shown to just one side or the other. And with these split-brain patients, they had the opportunity to test for any differences because the two halves couldn't communicate. And they made a pretty amazing discovery. If patients were shown an image on their left side that was received only by the right half of their brain, they couldn't say out loud what it was, but they could draw it. Once they drew it, they could then give it a name out loud. But they found no such deficiency for the opposite path. This experiment supported the idea that the ability to use language is located primarily in the left hemisphere. When input was sent only to the right, they couldn't use their words to describe it. This study is often credited with being the foundation of cognitive neuroscience, and for it, they won the Nobel Prize. And so that's what this research did. Now let's talk about what it didn't do. It didn't find evidence that the ability to draw was located in the right hemisphere. For that to have happened, the patients who saw something only on their right side should have been unable to draw what they saw, and they didn't find that deficiency. Patients weren't as good at drawing with their non-dominant hand, but that didn't change much based on which side something was shown. That experiment also didn't find evidence for individual differences, meaning that what they found was pretty general to everyone in the study. With some pretty rare exception, we all have our abilities to generate and understand language associated with activating in the left hemisphere of our brains. There are a handful of other functions that seem to be associated with one side of the brain more than the other. But most of the time, these are things that vary by the task, not by the person. Which is to say, if you bring a creative person and a mathematical person into the lab and give them both a task that requires them to use language, they'll probably both show some similar activation on their left side. And finally, they didn't test anything having to do with personality or intelligence. Surveys you see today that claim to be based in this research will also claim to give insights into your personality, your ways of thinking, and also sometimes even your cognitive abilities. And maybe if you squint, you could see how the distinction between using spoken language and drawing a picture could give you that impression, but they didn't actually test for that sort of thing in these experiments. We do, however, have decades of research on stable individual differences in personality, meaning things that make some people different from others seem to be consistent over time and can result in observable patterns of behavior. And we have evidence that there are neurological differences associated with some of these traits, but it's almost never a result of one hemisphere showing more activation than the other. See, the thing is, we're actually on the same page about the neuroscience. I know that describing people as left-brained or right-brained doesn't have to do with their actual brains, but it's an idea, it's a metaphor, it helps me understand people, and it helps me be understood. To that I say, it's not the best idea. It's quite a reductive way to organize people. The test results I provided at the start at least get some credit for providing a percentage, saying, well, you're not just completely left or right-brained. Even with that small point in its favor, it still leads to some bizarre conclusions. For example, why is memory on the opposite side of analytic and rational? Usually, better memory is positively correlated with measures of general intelligence. And does valuing organization mean you can't have a rich emotional life? Or are you just as likely to excel at both? And the original finding that led to this false dichotomy was about language. Good use of language requires a whole lot of creative aesthetic abilities in addition to a whole lot of rational organizational abilities. Why would you stick language to just one side? So it seems as though this idea, originally born from a bit of groundbreaking research about how brains work, grew into a myth bigger than was ever intended. But why did that happen? Well, partially because we all have a bit of motivation to understand ourselves and others. However, we can do a whole lot better at understanding ourselves and others than this, and that will be the subject of some upcoming episodes. See you then.